To see you.
How are you doing?
Surviving, just surviving.
Pitam, you're always thriving, yeah. You're never surviving.
Tough days.
So, when shall we start the session?
Okay. Yeah, so I think many, they met so many people, they can all join, yeah.
Sorry, could you come again, sir?
I said there are many people here. All of you can join in the discussion.
Certainly, they will at some point.
Yeah, I think we should all get together to tear Mr. Iyer apart.
Amitabh, we have our revenge match is coming up, by the way.
On or off the tennis court?
I think we are referring to golf.
Mr. Iyer has never won a single game of golf from us.
Come on, last time we were one all and you and the CAG fluked the deciding. I don't know if KP is on.
We've been trying for the last 2 years, not won a single game.
No one can beat Amitabh anyway.
Happy to partner with you, Mr. Iyer, anytime. Again.
No, great. Plus, Amitabh has got a friendly caddy.
No, if Pragya is your partner, you may win. Yeah.
Hi, Mr. Khan.
Yeah, of course.
I think I need to get someone like Pragya on the road. He'll be joining soon.
Okay, shall we start?
Yeah.
I think we should start.
Okay. Yeah.
We started the live stream, so we are live on YouTube as well. So, good evening, everyone. Welcome to our Stephanian virtual panel discussion, which we have titled as Meet the Author, Mr. Parameshwaran Iyer, in conversation with Mr. Rajiv Mehrishi, Mr. Amitabh Kant, and Ms. Shireen Bunn, on his recently launched book, Method in the Madness, organized by the Alumni Association of St. Stephen's College. So as we begin today's panel discussion, may I invite the principal of St. Stephen's College, Professor John Vergis, to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, Professor Vergis.
Thank you, Ms. Anne. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and welcome to this very special first meeting of its kind from the Alumni Association. This is a meeting which should have been conducted almost 2 months ago, but because of COVID, we delayed it so that we are not found wanting in our awareness and our responsibility towards society and what all of us and society has been going through. This is the first time that the Alumni Association of College is hosting a book discussion. It's a matter of great pride and privilege that the number of books that are being written and published by the alumni are increasing, and it's increasing on a variety of subjects. This afternoon, we are very honored to have Mr. Parameshwaran Iyer, former Secretary to the Government of India, share his thoughts in a discussion with three other former students of the college. I want to welcome each one of you and thank you personally from college for your time, which I know is very valuable, and for this effort of agreeing to come to college and make this the platform for what I'm sure is going to be a very, very engaging discussion. As I welcome each one of you and our distinguished audience, I would like to thank Ms. Anne Susan for the work which has gone into the planning and preparation for this event. Thank you, Mr. Iyer, for agreeing to talk about this book. And I'm confident that there will be many more such book discussions, book launches, and other such occasions to nudge our creative and intellectual interests. Let me assure each one of you that college will always be there for it. I'm not very sure if that works the other way around all the time. In many ways, college is like a parent. And like we all know, children are very fond of taking advantage of their parents. But let me tell you that there is no greater joy for college and the college community to see their alumni do well. Just like how a parent has immense and immeasurable joy in seeing and declaring the achievements of their children. So thank you, everybody. Welcome to this wonderful opportunity to share our experiences. Thank you, Anne.
Thank you, Professor Burgess. Dear Stephanians, it is truly a pleasure to have us all come together this evening. I'm very happy to introduce our esteemed panelists for this session now. But before I do that, may I also quickly add that amongst the participants who have joined us this evening, we not only have former students of college, but we also have the current students of college who have shown interest for this event. So it's wonderful, truly a delight to have us all come together as a community, although virtually. Without further ado, may I introduce our wonderful, esteemed panelists who may really not need much of an introduction because of the good work they have done and that they continue to do. But nonetheless, let me begin my task. To begin with, may I introduce two of the participants, Mr. Parameshwaran Iyer, the author of Method in the Madness. Mr. Iyer is from the class of 1978 and he pursued English when he was in college. Mr. Iyer is currently the global lead for strategic initiatives in the World Bank's Water Global Practice. Prior to this, he served as secretary to the Government of India at the Department of Drinking Water and Sanitation from March 2016 until August 2020. Where he had also led the implementation of the flagship Swachh Bharat mission. A former IAS officer, Mr. Iyer has headed innovative community-led Swajal project in Uttar Pradesh and Uttarakhand in the 1990s and has over the past 25 years and has over 25 years of global experience in the water and sanitation sector and has worked in many countries, including Vietnam, China, Egypt, and Lebanon. Now, a little bit about his recent book, which we are discussing today, Method in the Madness, Insight from My Careers as Insider, Outsider, Insider. Method in the Madness is published by HarperCollins and is the story of Mr. Iyer from cracking the IAS in 1981 to becoming a globe-trotting World Bank technocrat to playing the role of a coach to his professional tennis-playing daughter, and to his return back to India and working with the Indian government's flagship program, the Swachh Bharat mission. In this book, Mr. Iyer reflects on his unique career and the choices he made along the way, providing key management insights, practical career advice, and valuable life lessons. Written with humor and wisdom, this is an inspiring read that will resonate with readers at any age or stage of their life or career. Thank you for joining us, Mr. Iyer. And now we have Mr. Rajiv Maharishi. I think sir will join us in just some time, or he has already. He's here already. Perfect. Mr. Rajiv Maharishi is from the class of 1975, and he read history when he was in college. And Mr. Maharishi is the 13th Controller and Auditor General of India and Vice Chairman of the United Nations Panel of External Auditors. He's a retired Indian Administrative Service Officer of 1978 batch belonging to the Rajasthan cadre. He has previously served as the Home Secretary to the Government of India and the Chief Secretary to the Government of Rajasthan. We welcome and thank Mr. Rajiv Maharishi for joining us this evening. We have also joining us here with us, Mr. Amitabh Kant. He is from the class of 1976 and he read economics when he was in college. Mr. Amitabh Kant is an IAS officer of the 1980 batch Kerala cadre. As of June 2019, he is the Chief Executive Officer of Niti Aayog. He's also an author, and he's the author of Branding India, An Incredible Story, The Path Ahead, Transformative Ideas for India, and Incredible India 2.0, Synergies for Growth and Governance. We thank you and welcome Mr. Khan for joining us. And of course, we have our wonderful panelist, Ms. Shireen Bunn, who has joined us. She's from the class of 1997. And in that sense, she's the youngest panelist here today. And she read philosophy when she was in college. Ms. Bunn is an Indian journalist and news anchor. She's the managing editor of CNBC TV 18. Over the course of a 15-year career in journalism, Ms. Bunn has been the recipient of the Best Business Talk Show Award at the News Television Awards twice. She's also won the City Woman of the Year Award for her contribution to media in 2005 and the Best Business Anchor Award at the News Television Awards in 2013. Thank you so very much for joining us, Ms. Bunn. And this session will be moderated by none but Ms. Bunn. So over to you, Ms. Bunn, and we look forward to having a fantastic session with our esteemed panelists.
Thank you very much, Anne. Thank you, Professor, for the opportunity to do this here this evening. We were really hoping that we'd be able to do this in person in college over Mints, but unfortunately, COVID-19 has spoiled those plans. But I'm glad that we're able to have this conversation virtually. You know, I've had the privilege and the pleasure of not just reading Mr. Iyer's book, but also doing a similar sort of conversation with him and a few other panelists a few months ago when he launched the book. And I have to say, it's a wonderful book. It really gives you a behind-the-scenes account of what it takes to govern India. And I, of course, had the privilege and the pleasure of speaking with Mr. Khan for many, many years now over the course of my 20-year-long career, and, of course, with Mr. Maharishi as well. So thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us here today. You know, let me get straight to it, because we've got about 45 minutes, and I can see that there's a lot of people who've logged on to this virtual chat room to be able to participate. And I'm hoping that we can make this as engaging and as interactive as possible. But Mr. Iyer, you know, to you first, as the insider, outsider, insider, now back to being an outsider perspective, you know, the title of the book, Method in the Madness, some would argue, and this is not a recent criticism, but this has been a sort of age-old criticism, that the madness is created by the bureaucrats themselves, by the bureaucracy itself. In fact, you know, many argue in the recent times, in the context of this goal that the Prime Minister has envisioned of a new India, that perhaps new India also needs to be, in the words of one public policy expert, a bureaucrat mukt Bharat. How do you respond to that?
Thanks a lot, Shireen, and thanks to Amitabh and Mr. Maharishi for joining us and everyone in on the online call. You're right. You know, this title, Method and the Madness, actually came from my wife, Indira, who encouraged me to write this book when the lockdown started in the first phase. It essentially, I was trying to reflect the kind of more or less crazy career all of us have, particularly in the civil service. A lot of ups and downs, a lot of twists and turns, and a lot of highs and lows. And you go through a lot, particularly in your early days in the field, but also later. And all of us have tried to bring some method into that craziness. And so this is an attempt to tell that story. And it's not just in the civil service, but, you know, life is pretty hectic and crazy, even outside in the bank, and very interesting. And for me, it's a positive spin on the variety, the unpredictability, and the sheer fun of a career in the civil service, but also, you know, being a road manager in the bank. So I think that civil servants, and I'm sure others will win, you know, we have tried to bring some method into unpredictable, quite chaotic situations. And some of us, you know, we succeeded many times, we have failed a few times. And I think I just tried to bring in that sense of how, you know, we have all tried to navigate through perilous situations, but had good times and bad times as well. So it's a reflection of that.
Yes, it certainly is a reflection of that. And I think in your last assignment, driving Swachh Bharat, I think you had to bring to bear both your Sarkari skills as well as your specialist skills and deliver on a very audacious goal in the 3.5 years that you were given. But Mr. Kant, let me take that across to you, what we just heard there from Mr. Iyer. The challenges of governing a complex nation like India with its federal structure. And again, I go back to the criticism that is often placed at the door of the bureaucracy, that it is the bureaucrats and the bureaucracy that has made India ungovernable or difficult to govern. How do you respond to that, especially in the context of what we heard from the Prime Minister in February this year, where, fine, he's talking in the creation of perhaps privatization, perhaps wealth creation, but it was a comment that resonated with the large majority of the Indian population, where he talked about why should the IAS be the repository of all wisdom, so to speak. I'm paraphrasing, but how do you respond to that?
Shireen, there are bureaucrats and bureaucrats, and I've been a long time believer in the fact that every job that I've done, whether it was trying to make Kerala a tourism destination, or working with traditional fishermen in Kerala, or working in Government of India for Incredible India, or much later Secretary DPIT, all these jobs, I've actually believed that real success lies in partnership with the private sector. So I've always believed that a civil servant must act as a great facilitator. He must be a great catalyst. It's important to work with your beneficiaries. I mean, and for me, the beneficiary really is in many of my jobs, whether it was the traditional fisherman or the private sector, it was a partnership effort. And therefore, I've never believed that rules and regulations are an end in themselves. And I quite often believe that these rules and regulations constantly need to be modified to achieve the larger goal of growth and prosperity and progress. Now, quite often, some civil servants feel that, there are rules and regulations and you need to work according to rules. I've quite often believed in breaking the rules. And it's important that the end objective of providing not merely prosperity to India, but ensuring that the Indian citizens lead a very easy and simple life. And, there's easiness of living is very important. And that's one of the things I tried to do when I was Secretary DIPP. The first thing I did was ease of doing business, on which over a period of next 2-3 years, we jumped up about 79th position in the World Bank ease of doing business. But over the years, the Indian bureaucracy has created so many rules, regulations, procedures, and then they start thinking that it's an end in itself. And that's something which needs to be put in the mind of all civil servants as soon as they get into the academy in Mussoorie, that they need to break the rules and regulations and procedures with the objective of providing larger good to the citizens of India. And, I'm a believer that actually it's the easiness and simplicity of things which will ensure India to achieve. India needs to grow at very high rates of 9 to 10% per annum, year after year, year after year, for 3 decades or more. And that growth has to be provided by the private sector. That can't be provided by the government. The bureaucracy can only be a facilitator in that.
You're talking about breaking the rules, Mr. Kant. Let me go across to your former colleague, the former CAG, Mr. Rajiv Maharishi. He's making it sound easy, Mr. Maharishi, but let's be honest. When you start talking about breaking the rules, or even breaking away from set procedure, there is the fear of the CVC, there is the fear of the CBI, there is the fear of the CAG, which often forces bureaucrats to continue to work with the complexities of the system and not deliver for the people that they're meant to deliver to. So how do you respond to that?
Shireen, I can respond to this, and I think we should have a debate some other time on whether bureaucrats have bought more madness or more method to the system.
But that is the debate. That is the current debate.
So if you don't mind, I just like to say a few words about the book.
Yeah.
That we're here to discuss. Because some of the participants may not have read it. And so if you give me 5 minutes, I just like to talk about
Please.
The book.
Please.
So this is a book that I would recommend highly to all young people to read. Even though, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So even I'm in Goa, so my connectivity is poor. So even though a lot of these youngsters nowadays don't join the civil services, but there are certain lessons that this book brings to you, which are actually relevant to the whatever career that you are following, to your life itself. Now, first of these is very, very important, is the power of being well-read. I say this especially to my young audience, because I know that youngsters nowadays don't like to read much. They like to be on social media and see, you know, all kind of information bits, but they don't read much. And I would say that is one of the important lessons that this book brings out, that is the power of being well read. You know, secondly, a life lesson, there are many life lessons that need to be learned in this book. One is that both triumphs and disasters are imposters. Mm-hmm. So if we learn that, ancient wisdom has always taught us this, Gita says this, that both triumphs and disasters are imposters. Third thing about life is that, and again this book brings it out, is that you have to play the hand that you are dealt. Mm-hmm. You are not going to fix the cards, you will have to play the hand that you are dealt. Fourth important lesson is, again the book brings out, is that walk the straight and narrow. Nothing served anybody better than walking the straight and narrow. Shortcuts don't help. Being crooked doesn't help. Fifth important lesson to my mind is, knowledge and not authority command true respect. The sixth is, run harder if you are at the end of the line. The next one is, belief is a necessary condition for success. Eighth is that we must look outside our echo chamber. A lot of us have this habit of gathering, of having an opinion of ourselves, which is, you know, sort of buffeted by people around us, buttressed by people around us. Look outside of it and see what we really stand for and how the world perceives us.
Yeah.
And finally, one lesson of life is, expect the unexpected. Now, having said that, there are other things which are more germane to life as a bureaucrat that this book brings out. But I would say, Shireen, that it does sadden me that youngsters nowadays, Stephanians especially, are not joining the civil services. Mm-hmm. You know, I think from my experience of over 4 decades in the government, I feel that Stephanians brought a lot more value to the services than many other colleagues of ours did. So Stephanians were known for their rectitude, for their honesty, relative honesty, etc. And therefore, it is a bit saddening for me that the youngsters nowadays, especially from college, don't join the civil services. And I don't know what the reason for that is. But I can tell you that it's one of the most interesting careers. It's the only career which you can actually contribute if you have a positive attitude of mind. When Amitabh Kant speaks of breaking rules, he doesn't mean that you break every rule in the book and you do everything wrong. What he means is that when the rule comes in the way of a positive decision, then that rule, after all, rule is written for us. We are not there for the rules. So we have to then interpret that rule in a manner that leads to a positive outcome. So if you join the civil services, there is, you know, as in Parmeshwaran's words, you know, there is, the chance to be relentlessly curious, love your challenges, to have challenges on a daily basis, and you have a drive to find practical solutions. So that is what I have to say about the book and about my regret that my junior colleagues from college are no longer joining the civil services. This is very unlike the 70s, you know, when out of a batch of 120 IS officers, 40 or 45 used to be from St. Stephen's College. So now I don't know, that doesn't seem to happen anymore, and that is regrettable. We can come, Shireen, I can talk about other things about, you know, so I've clarified that point that when Amitabh talks of breaking rules, it is finding a practical solution. And it is also equally true that at times the oversight agencies in their zealousness sometimes take rules too literally and try to pin down people for taking right decisions because they violated some small petty procedure. Now, as the CAG, whoever the CAG is or whoever the CBC is or whoever Director CBI is, it's really his job, his or her job, to see that when his colleagues are being overzealous, that they are put on the right path and told that when the intent is clear, don't worry about the procedure. But intent is something which is sometimes difficult to see, so there may be some errors on that part. But on the whole, I would say that Amitabh's line on breaking rules should be read too literally. It has to be read in spirit.
No, absolutely. I get the point that you're making. And thank you very much for very comprehensively putting down or listing down some of the key nuggets or the key takeaways from Mr. Iyer's book. But Mr. Iyer, on that point, let me pick up what we just heard there from Mr. Mehrishin. I'll ask you this in the context of your experience of running Swachh Bharat. In your own words, this was a hairy, audacious goal that the Prime Minister gave you to take forward, and you had 3 years to be able to deliver it. What were the complexities, the challenges that you had to deal with? And, for a country like ours, when we're talking about dealing with central government agencies, state government agencies, that it's important to take both along, what do you believe the practical solutions need to be in order for us to be able to see that happen?
Right, Shri. I think both as Mr. Mehrishin and Amitabh have said, governing India or, in a federal context is very, very complex. Center, state, district, community, and particularly when you're, trying to deliver a program which, as Amitabh said, is trying to improve the quality of lives, particularly women and girls in rural India. And you have a lot of resistance to that in the beginning. And I found that in the beginning, one of the big challenges was, a lot of skepticism about the possibility of success of this very ambitious program, in a very audacious manner announced by the Prime Minister from the Red Fort. There had not been much progress in rural sanitation in India since independence. And then, we were given a 5-year window. So the big challenge was to take that vision of the Prime Minister and in a sense convert it into a mission, but essentially getting the states and districts to deliver. Because as you know, sanitation is a state subject. Mm. So when I joined, some of my own senior officers said, sir, this is going to be very, very challenging. An announcement has been made, but how do we get state governments? And in some cases, state governments run by political parties different from the center. How do we get them to deliver? And so I think, and frankly, I had a lot of consultations with both Mr. Mehrishin and Amitabh and Neeti as how to set about this. Amitabh had already done a lot of work with the states. There's a lot of talk of competitive, collaborative federalism. And in a sense, it was important to transfer our worry about getting the job done to the states. So getting them to own it, incentivizing the state governments, the collectors, the sarpanches. So that became a big challenge. And, for that, we had to become traveling salesmen. We had to go to the field, make the case, motivate them, and get them to understand that this is for their own good. And once the communities understood the importance of sanitation from a health point of view, from an economic point of view, from a dignity point of view, then I think they took charge. So translating our concerns to them and getting them to take the leadership role, I think that was the only way we could set about it. And also to have a little bit of friendly competition amongst the states. So there was a bit of a race in the beginning to become open defecation free. And we went for the low hanging fruits. Amitabh said of Kerala was leading. So it was Himachal Pradesh, Kerala, Haryana, Uttarakhand. And I think those early wins set the trend. People started believing it was possible. Young collectors, young civil servants started giving very high priority leading the program, involving the communities, getting NGOs on board. And then Shireen, all of you in the media, you also helped a lot. So it was partnership, as Amitabh said, with the private sector, with the media, with NGOs, and getting everyone on board. But it was also important, as I mentioned in the book, and grateful to Mr. Mehrishin for pointing out some of those pro tips, is to get key stakeholders in the government of India, inform them about the progress and get their support as well. And of course, we had the wind at our back. We had the Prime Minister of India. never missing an opportunity to talk about the program, whether it was on Mann Ki Baat or whether it was in public rallies. And that helped a lot, particularly when I was working, dealing with chief ministers and kind of reminding a few of the states which were lagging behind that this was an important program which the prime minister was personally interested in. So I think dealing with all those challenges, it was good fun, but it was a lot of work as well.
Yeah, I would imagine a lot of work indeed, you know, from communicating to troubleshooting, you know, all part of what you had to do. That was a regular day for you. But Mr. Kant, you know, to the point that was being made there by Mr. Iyer, and I'll get both you and Mr. Maharishi to comment on that. You know, this business of where policy is set in Delhi or, you know, in whichever state capital it may be, but the execution actually happens on the ground. And for the execution to be dealt with effectively and for it to actually benefit the people that the policy was made for, you need to ensure that there is decentralization. I'll ask you this in the context of what we're seeing happen with the vaccine program, for instance. You know, while there can be central procurement, leave the actual execution to the agencies on the ground, whether it's state or local authorities. Now, what is the fine balance in your assessment? I want to get the three of you to comment on this issue because I think it's topical, relevant, and current. Mr. Kant, I'll start by asking you.
So, Shireen, for years, you know, I mean, ever since I joined service, for years we've been doing this physical and financial management of different programs. What has transformed now is that, you know, technology enables you to get a lot of data today, and it's possible for you to do outcome management based on real-time data. And that's one of the key things that today you can actually assess performance minute to minute, second to second, and actually put out performance records. So if you were to say assess on health or learning outcomes or health outcomes, and which we are doing in aspirational districts, say for instance, on 49 different indicators, we collect data and put it out on monthly basis to the district. When I was a district collector, I was not knowing how my district was performing. The data which was available was about 6 to 7 years old. But today it enables you to get minute to minute, and we put out ranking on a monthly basis. And we say this district has performed well on the delta, that is the change during the course of the month. And therefore, everybody knows whether he's performing or failing. And everybody knows who's come first, who's come second, who's come last. And that is the real transformation that has taken place over the last few years. That today, the ability, the power of technology, the power of data, the power of your ability to analyze, and the power to put out rankings and name and shame people in terms of sheer performance is so enormous that you can do any policy, but your assessment must be on the basis of defined outcomes. So first and foremost, move to defined outcomes. Have the clarity that this is the outcome which I want to achieve. It's not just the spending of money, but the end result of what we want to achieve with those with that money. And therefore, whether that outcome has been achieved or not, you can analyze, you can examine. And I'm a great believer that delivery will take place if your outcomes are clearly, if every government scheme has the outcome very clearly defined, and then you are able to monitor it based on very clear data. And now real-time data is possible, real-time data, and keep putting that out. If you keep putting that out, you will see a huge transformation in India. And you will see massive, massive change in India. That is, to my mind, really the key. You can have policy centrally driven, but you should define outcomes of that. Every single policy must have clear outcomes. Get the delivery execution on ground. But all this needs tremendous momentum, as Param has demonstrated. You know, he's a very inspirational person. He's demonstrated. You know, one fine morning, he just picked me up from my house and took me to a village 6 hours away in Uttar Pradesh and made me clean a twin toilet there. And, you know, then after cleaning that up, we went and sat with the panchayat. The local panchayat was then the toilet panchayat. It was the toilet panchayat of that area. And all of them committed to making that particular panchayat open defecation free. They all passed their own resolution saying it's an open defecation free. So what he demonstrated was that it's not possible to achieve results in India without a mass movement. He converted sanitation into a Jan Andolan, and that is the key. If you want to achieve transformation in India, many of these programs and policies which we draw up on paper need to be converted into a Jan Andolan. And without a mass momentum behind it, nothing will succeed in India. And therefore, what he achieved was his ability to drive change with people's participation. That was the key to the success of the Swachh Bharat movement.
Yeah, Mr. Maheshwari, I wanted to comment on that. One, of course, is the point that Mr. Kanth was making on having very clear outcomes. And we've experimented that even as far as our budget making is concerned, trying to put an outcome budget in place, but didn't go very far. One is, of course, collecting data, analyzing data, and then using data effectively, and then transparently also communicating what the data is actually telling us. But more importantly, the point that Mr. Kanth was making there on people's participation, on getting those whose lives matter on account of the so-called reforms that are being taken forward to actually be equal owners or equal participants in the process itself. You know, how do you institutionalize that? I mean, you know, here we're talking about Param Iyer being somebody who decided to evangelize the cause of Swachh Bharat. But if you don't have a Param Iyer, how do you institutionalize this? You're on mute, sir.
Begin with the issue raised with Amitabh about federalism in India and how do you find a balance there. And that's actually a challenge because there's an argument for centrally sponsored schemes, which says that we must have national priorities. For example, being ODF, having sanitation is a national priority. And there's an equally valid argument that no scheme in Government of India can be drawn applicable to across the country. For example, electrifying a village in UP is quite a different challenge from electrifying a village in Rajasthan, which can have an area of 200 square kilometers. Similarly, building a toilet in Rajasthan, which has no water, and more important than water, the fact is that your toilet itself may get, sand duned. Yeah. If there's a big sandstorm, which are quite common in Western Rajasthan, then say building a toilet in Himachal Pradesh or building one in UP. So centrally sponsored schemes, on the whole, it has been my belief for a long, long time, and I have been stating this in various forums, that centrally sponsored schemes more or less are likely to fail because they tend to have one one size fit all approach to the whole of India, and India is too diverse to have that kind of approach. Yeah. So in 2011, Mrs. Rajay wrote an article which got published in Indian Express. It's called An Unequal Balance. And I recommend that some of you read it because it really brings out the issues, the difficulties with centrally sponsored schemes. Having said that, it's rare for a centrally sponsored scheme to be a success. We have seen IRDP in the 80s. We have seen Antyodaya in the 1980s. What did they do? Did they bring the poor out of poverty till date? They haven't. So really speaking, they failed in that sense. But this is the one scheme that Parmeshwar and Iyer ran, and as he rightly points out himself repeatedly in the book and even today, yeah, with the backing of political backing of the Prime Minister, this was a success. And this was a success because, as you put it, Parmeshwar and Iyer was able to make it into a program that everybody got to own. And Amitabh helped, by sort of bringing out the winners and the losers, and therefore setting a race amongst the states. So this is clearly an exception to my mind. I can't recall very many centrally sponsored schemes that have succeeded even partially, much less as fully as the scheme for ODF or for sanitation in India succeeded. So this is an example. So this is a great example to learn from as to what made it tick and what made it a success. And I think Parmeshwaran brings it out very clearly in the book, the various factors that went into making this program a success. And I must say this in the course of reputation, that political backing of the kind that the Prime Minister gave, I don't think very many people could have imagined before his the Prime Minister would speak about toilets in a speech from the Red Fort, which yeah. Prime Minister Modi did. I think the year was 2015. So, yep. Or 15. So, the point is that basically that kind of backing, if you have politically, you can do wonders. And then you have to have proper job, which most bureaucrats would not like to do. It is not seen as a very sort of high profile job. Parmeshwaran liked the job. He was, you know, he really took it up as a mission, and he loved doing what he was doing. So, which is what, you know, so, and that, you know, to my mind brings another lesson in life, that whatever yeah. is worth doing is worth doing well. And I commend Parmeshwaran for that, that, you know, when he was doing that job, he was doing it with the full will and vigor that anything that requires to be done well needs, that other kind of vigor is required.
You know, important point that you make on centrally sponsored schemes. I think, you know, several finance commissions in the recent past have red flagged that as an issue, including the 15th Finance Commission. And perhaps the time has really come to rationalize and clean up. I don't think there is a number that we even have as far as how many centrally sponsored schemes that they are. You might have one.
So there's a joke there that I have won many a bet, including with Amitabh Kant and with the former CA, Arvind Subramaniam, challenging them that they cannot count the number of centrally sponsored schemes that the government of India runs. Nobody in the government of India can give you a number.
Yes, I would imagine.
So I won many a bet on that, and I continue to win those bets because there's no way that you can count them.
No way that.
When he was trying to do the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals,
yeah.
when he was doing the SDGs and trying to link the ministries, I think he counted up to 1,084. That's the yeah. last I interacted with him on that subject, and then he stopped counting it.
the time has come. Yeah, the time has come to address this problem and face it, and perhaps it could change the way that devolution will take place, at least as far as the next finance commission is concerned. But Ms. Iyer, you know, I want to come back again to the issue that was being raised here by Rajiv Maharishi at the start, sort of, you know, feeling disappointed about the fact that we don't have enough young Stefanians who are taking to the civil services. Now, as somebody who spent years in the civil service and years outside of the civil service, you may have started off your career as an accidental bureaucrat, leaving the tennis court to join the IAS. But, you know, in light of the experience that you've had and having seen both sides of the coin, so to speak, what is your advice to young people who are looking at the possibility of this as a career?
Shireen, hearing both Mr. Maharishi and Amitabh, first of all, I have to tell you that both of them entered toilet pits at my request. They were incredibly sporting. Mr. Maharishi did it in Pune, and of course, I dragged Amitabh early morning to Ferozabad. And it was phenomenal to see these public figures, you know, emptying toilet pits. I think it sparked off a huge momentum. But coming back again, and in fact, influence a lot of young civil servants about whom you have asked me. Now, I've always said, there's no more satisfying career, as both Amitabh and Mr. Maharishi have said, than the civil service. In fact, I've been responsible, and some of my batchmates have accused me of influencing their kids to take the exam and actually getting in, when they were quite happy in the second generation of joining the private sector. In my job, you know, when I came in, I was technically a lateral entrant because I'd left the IAS. But the fact that I'd been in the civil service, I think, was the overwhelming factor of success in whatever progress we made in the Swachh Bharat mission, because it's the network, it's the ability to pick up the phone and call up the chief secretary or to walk into Amitabh's office. Of course, we knew each other in college. That's another huge network. But the ability to make transformational change and impact on the ground is unprecedented in the IAS. And I wouldn't have changed that for anything else. I worked in the World Bank. And when anyone says, what is the most satisfying stint in your career, apart from being a road manager to my daughter Tara, which I think was great, and my son Venkat as well, I think just that experience of delivering on the ground, of being able to solve big problems, address big challenges, is unprecedented. So my message to youngsters, particularly those from college, I don't know if we'll ever get back to that golden era of the of Mr. Maharishi and Amitabh, when 40% of IAS officers were from college. But I would encourage them to take the civil service exam. It's a phenomenal career, and you can always make a shift later, like I did. So I think that you have the ability, that that experience of delivering on the ground is invaluable in any international organization. So you can actually go out, and maybe if you're lucky, like I was in Fredrik, you can come back in as well. So that's my message to anyone, to particularly youngsters from college who are not sure about a career for themselves.
You know, you brought up the issue. Yes, Mr. Maharishi, go ahead.
Especially if you're not as exceptional as Shireen Bhan to make a career in journalism.
Well, that's really exceptional. I'll take that compliment, sir. I will take that compliment. But I want to go back to the larger issue that Mr. Iyer raised there on lateral entry. And this is something that has been debated ad nauseum, at least, you know, for the past decade plus. As the way forward and as the reform forward as far as the IAS is concerned. So let me ask you this, Mr. Kant, before I get Mr. Iyer and Mr. Maharishi to weigh in on this. As we look at reforming, overhauling, whatever you'd like to call it, making the IAS and the bureaucracy much more relevant for the times that we live in, what do you believe is the need of the hour, you know, between career bureaucrats as well as specialists? And how do you believe where do you believe the specialists should come in? You know, what should their role and contribution be as we move ahead? You're on mute.
You know, one of the first few things I did when I joined Niti Aayog was to get a lot of lateral entrants. And Niti Aayog is just full of young people, you know, young professionals. We have a flexi pool of specialists and so on. And actually, they're all wonderful people. They've done really outstanding work in Niti Aayog. They've created their own energy, vibrancy, and dynamism. And my belief is that you know, the service does a phenomenal job in the first few years in the field. You know, they do some outstanding work when they are SDMs and district collectors, and they work in the states. Once you become joint secretary at a senior level, after you put in about 18 years of service, you should face competition from anyone else, and you should be better than anybody else. And I'm quite sure that even if you allow competition at that level to take place, you will see many of the IAS guys doing much better. Nothing to be afraid of. You know, the multifaceted personality, especially of the Stefanians who get into the IAS, is way ahead of any lateral entrants who will come in. So they'll outsmart anyone else. And, you know, but I don't think we should stop competition with after having put in about 20 years of service. Allow lateral entrants to come in. And even guys, you know, I mean, there'll be very, very few people with this kind of experience. You know, the kind of experience you got. At a very young age, I got this experience of, you know, working with traditional fishermen in Kerala, you know, providing them new technology, outboard motors, fishing nets, new crafts, opening their bank accounts, really transforming that. That kind of an experience only this service provides. Transforming a state in the world of tourism, only this service provides. Or, you know, branding and marketing, only this service provides. But after about 20 years, you should be confident enough to face any competition head on. So I think lateral entrance after the level of joint secretary is fine. We should take it head on and outsmart anybody else. And, you know, the guys who will make it big are those, you know, guys in the service who have this enthusiasm and zeal and the energy to continue to do well, who have the ability to think big. And like Param has demonstrated, you know, he was constantly in the field. He was one of the reasons for the success of this program was that Param was never in his office. He was constantly in the move. He was not a file man. he was constantly traveling. He was inspiring young officers. And, you know, a lot of his enthusiasm rubbed off on others. He was a man of details. He was taking states and districts along. Mm-hmm. And that is what the service is all about. And that's why, you know, it's a fascinating service. It's a unique service. The experience you get nowhere else in the world, will you get this? The ability to transform lives of citizens, you'll never get again. But after about 20 years, and it should be both ways. IAS officers should also be allowed to get into other places. It's not that lateral entrants can get into the government and the government officers are not supposed to get out. You know, that's not fair. So it should be lateral entrance either way, and government guys should be allowed to get into the private sector and transform the private sector. They'll do a much better job than the private sector executives, I can tell you.
Okay. You know, we've got a question coming in from Suraj Jacob, and I think he was alluding to the point. Yes, Mr. Maharishi, go ahead.
I think, you know, we should understand what he was saying. What he was saying was, I think he was basically arguing against state control, industry, state control of every activity in India. So basically, it is because if government controls it, then naturally everything, including road transport corporations, beverages corporations, etc. So yeah. Basically, the argument there is that, really speaking, a lot of activities are not. It is not the business of government to be in business. Mm. So I think that's what he was arguing for, and that's how we should read it. And a lot of us in government, frankly, I can say for myself personally, I can say for Amitabh, we have really pushed for privatizations. We were amongst the happiest individuals in that small spirit of privatization that took place during Mr. Bajpayee's regime. I think that was the right way to go for this country. We can't be making tractors and watches, and we can't be running bus services and trains and the whole lot of thing. So I think that has been at the cost of running more important things. You know, we should have been concentrating on health and education, you know, rather than, you know, running transport corporations. So really speaking, that is the argument that is being made. And we are absolutely... the answer is not to only get private sector guys to run joint secretary's jobs. After all, what will a private sector guy do in a joint secretary's job? He'll do the same bureaucracy that an IAS officer does. Mm-hmm. The idea is to somehow find the government to be the enabler, the facilitator. And what we need in this country is a tango between the private and the public sector. Yeah. So far, everything has been done by the public sector, and which is why we are in the dire straits that we are in. The moment we learn to tango, the moment we learn that policy and regulation is a government job, running things, doing business is a private sector job, and they are best at it, it doesn't matter who's in the private sector. You know, Amitabh could be in the private sector tomorrow, I could be in public sector, and vice versa, and it still would not make a difference. Having said that, we must also learn one lesson that we really need to learn is from the United States of America on this. You know, I'm not a great sort of fan of USA on this. They never embraced the policy reason to run things. You know, they've never done so. The result is that all their leading policymakers in government, beginning with Henry Kissinger is one example, have actually been, you know, professors in universities or something who have come and run those departments. So a lot of these, policymakers in the USA actually come from both private sector as well as universities as well as the army. That would also automatically happen if really didn't run everything by government. So the problem in this today is our inheritance of this so-called Indian variant of socialism, you know, which actually meant a control of everything by the government, you know, which is what has made a mess of things to my mind.
If I could add a line to that, clearly a variant of concern, and that is the consensus here on the panel. But Suraj Jacob sent in a question, and that goes back to the point that Amitabh Kant was making about why Swachh Bharat succeeded, because you had a traveling salesman on the ground. Ms. Iyer, this question is specifically for you, that, you know, your team in Delhi was linked directly with district administrations, and this must have inevitably created tensions with state administrations, at least in some states. That's the caveat there. How did you deal with this?
Yeah, look, it's a great question. And, you know, that was always the challenge because, you know, coming from the UP cadre, we have a sort of golden formula, which is the PM, CM, DM lineup always works. Prime Minister, Chief Minister, District Magistrate, if you can align them in a federal system, usually you will have success. But again, it was a challenge. As Mr. Maharishi said, centrally sponsored schemes rarely succeed. So while we had to directly be in touch with young collectors, who are really integrators, right? They bring together health, education, they bring in sanitation, they bring in nutrition. So we wanted to have them on board, but it was obviously critical in parallel to have the state secretaries on board. So we made sure that we never bypassed the state secretaries in charge of sanitation or the chief secretary. We always kept them on board. Whenever we did video conferences, they would be involved. After all, funds were transferred to the state treasury. The state treasuries had to pass it on to the districts. So it was sometimes, you know, we had to tread a kind of delicate path in some states where there were political challenges. So where we had to deal directly with officers as opposed to politicians, but it was critical to keep the secretary or the principal secretary of a state on board, involve them so that they never felt left out and they supported their young collectors.
Yes, and that I think is an example that would serve us well for many other issues, especially in the context of what we're seeing happen with the GST. Often there isn't enough communication as well. There's a question in from Mr. Didar Singh. Should there be a method in the madness or some madness in the methods, Ms. Iyer?
Great question, and thanks for that question, sir. So, look, there's a lot of madness around, but I think that madness is only a sort of euphemism for the endless possibilities fraught with uncertainty. So, you know, you can look at it both ways. You know, all of us tried to bring some method into the madness of our respective careers, but I think the other way around works as well. And perhaps a little bit of that is required when Amitabh is putting from 6 feet, and hopefully, you know, he will miss that putt and we can win our next match.
Well, good luck to you. There's a question, and I'm going to post that to Mr. Kant because he was talking about having very clear set outcomes. In the private sector, targets are clearly spelled out. In the government, there are far too many players with too many agendas for a linear function. Policies and projects change dramatically depending upon various pulls and pressures. I would imagine you're well aware of that, Mr. Kant. So doesn't it make implementation a Herculean task for a rank outsider who may not have had Mr. Iyer's experience in the government and the World Bank?
Yeah, you know, but in the government, Shireen, it's your first few years. You establish your credibility. If you've delivered in the first 4 to 5 years of your service, you carry an image and you carry a track record, which will carry you through your career. You know, you'll go through all your tough, sir. You know, my first posting was in a very riot-torn area where there was killings going on, and I wanted to be really tough there. And what I did in those first five years of my career established me throughout. So you build up your credibility, you build up your image with that, and politicians then regard you as a professional. And one of the key things is that wherever you are, whether it's private or public, you have to be a thoroughbred professional. And if you're an outstanding civil servant, then it doesn't matter. You will deliver and you can. And what
parameters? No. I think the question is that if you're not a civil servant and you're coming into the civil service, if you don't have the, you don't understand intricacies of the service, how do you deal with it?
I was coming to that. And, you know, so similarly, the guys who've been selected, the lateral entrance, and you have 4 or 5 of them who've come in, and some of them, I've interacted with some of them, and they're doing very good job, you know, and one of them is working on the drone policy and civil aviation and all that. So you, again, you have this ability to do new. Why has a lateral entrant been brought in? Because he'll bring in fresh thinking. He'll do innovative thinking. He'll break the status quo. He will do something which is radically different. And that's why, you know, when the lateral entrants come in, they have this huge opportunity to bring in change, refreshing change, which is amazing. You know, I mean, they can bring the kind of the scale of change which you can bring through the government is enormous. And therefore, the lateral entrant will also build up his track record in the first few years. And I can tell you with my own experience in Niti Aayog, that some of these lateral entrants which we've seen here are just simply outstanding. They're really brilliant. They're the ones who are driving change in Niti Aayog is what it is because of these lateral entrants. So, you know, everyone in the first 2 to 3 years, build your track record, perform well. And let me tell you, the lateral entrants who got in here, worked with me for 3 years, they have got jobs, the kind of which no IAS officer can get anywhere in the world. So, I mean, they, because of their performance in Niti Aayog, they're all over. Someone's teaching in Princeton, someone's teaching in Harvard, someone has joined a private sector, somebody is working with some top class agency in New York. I mean, all kind of phenomenal figures. They are the ones driving growth all over the world now. So, my view is, much like Mr. Iyer, you know, in his method of madness, he could quit the IAS, go and train his daughter, come in back again, deliver here, go back to the World Bank. I mean, if you're an outstanding professional, you'll be picked up anywhere in the world. You just need to deliver.
Well, you know, speaking about delivery, Mr. Maharishi. Yes.
Let me answer that question more directly. For any lateral entrant to come in the position that Mr. Iyer came in, it would really be a challenge. Mr. Iyer had the advantage of having been in the civil services, which he admits to in the book.
Yeah.
Having said that, we should also remember that a person is not working in a, he's still working in a system. He or she is still working in a system. So basically, whatever difficulty he has with the system, there will be people below him and above him to guide him, you know, on how the system works, where the cabinet order is required, how a note is written, etc., what approvals are required, where you need to refer the file to other departments, etc. So while it will be a challenge, it is not an unsurmountable challenge. It will be more difficult for a lateral entrant to work in the government of India, but it is not unsurmountable because he or she will have enough ground to be on the to be able to meet the requirements of the system. But it will be an challenge, yes, on the whole.
Yeah, so it can be done, not an insurmountable challenge. But Ms. Iyer, I want to come back to you again on you know, two issues that that continue to be relevant. And these are not new issues, but continue to be relevant even today. One is the interface between the executive or policy and the judiciary. And, you know, the argument is the judiciary overstepping? The judiciary's rebuttal is that there is a policy vacuum which is leading to the judiciary being forced to sort of enter terrains or areas where the executive should be doing its job. You know, how do you see this going forward? What do you believe needs to be done in order for us to have a course correction, perhaps, if you believe that that is in fact needed? And, you know, Mr. Maharishi brought up the example of the U.S. Institutional independence, again, this is not something new as an issue in India, but it continues to be an area of concern. How do you ensure that we do safeguard our institutions and ensure that they act independently?
Sure. You know, on the first question, Shireen, on the role of the judiciary, obviously, it's got a critical role in a democracy. It's one of the four pillars, an independent judiciary. And I think that, you know, we have seen, you know, we might have seen some aberrations in that system over the years. But overall, I think the judiciary has upheld that, you know, has sort of fulfilled its role broadly. I think the more important thing is, which Amitabh and I were trying to work on, is getting the number of pending cases reduced, particularly in the lower courts. There's an enormous number of cases pending. So, you know, there's that old cliche about justice delayed is justice denied. And I think that, so we were trying to work, in fact, with the Supreme Court on, you know, on enabling the system. A lot of young officers have come up with new ideas using technology on how we can drastically reduce the number of pending cases and speed up justice in that sense. So I think, you know, while we can talk a lot about judicial independence and the and respecting institutions at a national level, the real challenge is at the lower level, where, you know, you've got millions of cases pending which need to be speedily disposed. And I think there needs to be a big effort to push that. On your second question, in terms of the US and, you know, independence of institutions, sure, here, you know, this kind of fierce independence almost taken to another extreme, particularly the states. In the beginning, in fact, of the pandemic, you know, many states refused to, you know, to go ahead with guidance from the federal government. And so in some respects, you know, there are many states in America, particularly the red states, which, you know, and there are many people who really don't believe in this vaccination at all. And they don't want anything from above, from government, particularly the federal government, to interfere with their lives. So I think that's another extreme. But in terms of respecting institutions and preserving the independence of institutions, you know, obviously that's a critical facet of democracy. The US, you know, they're very, very fiercely protective of it. And I think that it's equally important in India. And but again, we've seen many states in India, in our federal system, who are fiercely independent. And, you know, the recent trends have shown as well that states will decide, you know, what they want to do. And I think that's the way they should be. And in terms of other institutions, you know, we have people talk of, you know, the media sort of following a particular political line, but we have fiercely independent media as well in India. So I think that the trend is okay, but obviously, you know, it would be good if we could do this over a long term.
Mr. Maharishi, you want to come in on that?
I have only one line to say on this, Shireen. We are never going to grow at 9-10% per annum unless there is judicial reform. It's a contract, and contracts can't be enforced in less than a decade or two decades. Then really there can be no economic growth. Remaining, judiciary is so would so much attract the contempt of courts act that I would rather do it privately.
Mr. Kanta, you want to take a stab at this, or would you also rather do it privately?
No, I entirely agree with what Mr. Maharishi is saying, that, and I've been working on this ease of doing business for a long time. And my belief is exactly the same. The level of pendency is so enormous in India right now at all levels that actually it's not administrative reforms which are critical, it's judicial reforms is very critical. And I think the use of technology is very, very critical. The use of artificial intelligence is very important. And I, to my mind, he was talking about enforcement of contracts. I mean, how will you get investments in this country? How will FDI rise? How will you grow at high rates on a sustained basis if enforcement of contract doesn't take place in this country? And therefore, judicial reforms holds the key. All sectors of Indian economy have undergone a reform. Every single sector, including now the agriculture sector, has gone through a reform. The only sector which hasn't gone through a reform is the judiciary.
But wouldn't it also help if policy was consistent? If there was predictability of policy, then you wouldn't have to be at the doors of the judiciary if there was policy certainty, as opposed to retrospective action and so on and so forth.
No, I totally agree that there has to be policy predictability and consistency across the board. And I think increasingly the government is realizing that there has to be ease of doing business. There have to be less of rules, regulation. Over the years, we've been adding rules, regulation, procedures, acts, and laws. Many of these laws are actually now getting scrapped. 1,400 laws have been scrapped. We have to make India, all of us together, including the judiciary, we have to work with them to ensure that India becomes a far more easier and simpler place to work in. The only guys who are doing well in this world are people like Mr. Biswajit Bhattacharya. All the lawyers are flourishing in this world.
Well, he'll get his chance to comment at the end, but there's a question that's come in from Vikram Hari, where you know, he's talking about dealing with political masters As civil servants, and I know all three of you, and I know Mr. Iyer has spoken about this from his experiences at the start of his career in Bijnor to the later parts of his career, and I know that you have spoken about this as well, Mr. Khan. Mr. Iyer, let me start by asking you about that. You know, the pulls and pressures of dealing with political dispensations of different kinds, how do you deal with that? And how have you dealt with that? How challenging was it for you?
You know, I think as both Mr. Maharishi and Amitabh have said, you know, the early years of your career pretty much, you know, stay with you, that reputation you earn in the first 4 or 5 years of your career, they kind of help you throughout your career. And so early in your career, you know, you're going to face a lot of pulls and pressures at the local level. It might be an MLA, it might be a minister. And, you know, once they know that you are very clear about treading the straight and narrow, they're very practical and pragmatic, right? You know, they're going to leave you alone and they'll go to somebody else. So your reputation stands for itself, and the pressures and pulls on you decrease over time because people know that, you know, you're essentially going to give them a very professional advice. And in the government of India, it's a different equation. You're essentially dealing with your minister, and you know, and again, you know, if as long as you give professional advice, I think most politicians, most ministers, they respect you, and because that's what they sort of expect. They, in some cases, they may not like it; they may expect you to say something else, but they, you know, they're willing to deal with it. So I think that a little bit of unpleasantness, perhaps early in your career or early in your relationship with the minister, that sets the tone, and then after that, it smoothens out. At least that's been my experience.
Mr. Kant, how many unpleasant experiences have you had?
I've had many. I have suffered, I've brutally suffered in Kerala. Unlike these UP guys, get away easily. You know, down south, you have to suffer the commoners.
Mr. Maharishi?
So the answer, Shirin, is very clear. You know, just what I said in the beginning, quoting Param, walk the straight and narrow. Hmm. It put you into temporary discomfort from time to time, but in the long run, it really pays. The politicians respect you for being straight, and as long as you are not, you don't have your own personal agendas, whether they are money agendas or caste agendas, some other agendas, they respect that, and they, more than anybody else, they respect delivery. Please remember that the only group of people, we like to rubbish them, but please remember that the only group of people in this country who are really accountable are the politicians. They have to go back to the people in 5 years. So they are never going to disrespect delivery. You know, so if you're doing your job well, delivering, they will always respect that also. But if you have any personal agenda, or if you are not delivering, then naturally they have very little patience with you. So I can tell you that I, of course, work in a very sensible and balanced state. But I can tell you that I can say with great confidence that I have never had the misfortune of having what I might call a bad political or IAS boss. You know, because one just did one's job and somehow it always gelled with the bosses that I worked with. So idea is, and of course, if you do one wrong, then naturally they're going to push you, you know. So you can't sort of have double standard that you will make money on the side and then you will not do their incorrect work. So that you can't expect. But if you're not having your own agenda, then they won't even ask you beyond a point. They won't push you beyond a point. Hmm.
So it's a balance between loyalty and delivery, you know, and that's how do you navigate through that, Mr. Iyer?
There's no loyalty.
Okay, go ahead, Mr. Maharishi.
No loyalty at all. It's just that I don't have an agenda of my own. I'm doing my work. I don't have caste agenda. I don't have a money agenda. I don't have a publicity agenda. I don't have any agenda. I keep a very low profile because that profile, the politician wants, he can have it. And I am doing my work and delivering. That is as, and when it asks me to do a wrong thing, I can give you examples of what happened to me, you know, in elections. How one was asked and one was able to say no by saying that I won't do this at any cost. All right. So that also they respect as long as, but it can't be that suppose Parmeshwaran and Amitabh are in one election, I'm favoring Amitabh and I don't favor Parmeshwaran, then Parmeshwaran as a politician will have me. But if I favor neither, then of course they will keep off after a point. So I can tell you very honestly that politicians also know their limitations. They know very well the value of anybody who is working in the district or higher office honestly and diligently, and they value that and they respect that and let you alone. So there is it is not such a big issue as it is made out to be. As long as you, as I said, in the words of Parmeshwar, and walk the straight and narrow, that is important.
Shareen, just to add to that, also works the other way around. As I mentioned in the book, you know, we are typically expecting, conventional wisdom is the politicians, you know, need us to deliver their programs, which is true. The other way around, in the Swachh Bharat mission, I've mentioned it in this book, we leverage the leader big time, right? And in fact, someone in the PMO once told me that, you know, they said, sir, you know, you have quote unquote used the prime minister more than anyone else. You know, he was our communicator in chief. And whenever we got a chance, you know, if he were to address a large gathering or make a push for sanitation. So we used the leader. So you can also use politicians to do your legitimate work because they have got contact with the people, the communicators, they're charismatic as well.
Yeah. Mr. Kant, this is a question.
I mean, you know, everybody is not so lucky like Mr. Maharishi, never to get a bad boss, you know, but if you built up your credibility, if you built up your integrity, if you built up your image as a professional civil servant, and if you built up the ability to say no to a politician, I'll tell you, you may go down for a short while, but you'll always in the long run come out a winner.
You can't keep a good man or a good woman down for too long. And I think that's the question that Rene Jones has sent in, saying, how hard is it to dissent or disagree, with the center stand? I would imagine center or state, it doesn't matter, with the government stand. How hard is it, Mr. Kant, if you don't agree with the position taken, can you express dissent, whether privately or publicly?
Yeah. You do it all the time. You must express your views. You must express your views in a very honest, free and frank manner. I would suggest that you do it 99.9% of the time in a very direct personal manner, not in public, but do it frankly, one-to-one, and express your views. And I'll tell you, the politician will start respecting you more for that. And 90% of the time, he'll agree with your views then. And he'll change his own mind.
Ms. Iyer, have you had an occasion where you expressed dissent privately or publicly and then finally had your say?
Absolutely. When I was the DM in Bijnor, the then Chief Minister, Mr. Kalyan Singh, this was just before the Babri Masjid, incident. And there was some feedback from a couple of ministers in my district to the Chief Minister about the sort of, the way we were preparing, because we had intelligence that this thing was going to happen, right? And Bijnor is very sensitive communally. There's a large percentage of the minority population. And so then, there was feedback to the Chief Minister that, the collector and SP are sort of, bringing in preparations to deal with any potential incident, which, is not going to happen. So I got a call from the Chief Minister's office, from the Principal Secretary. And, I had to tell him that, listen, we don't know what's happening in Lucknow or in Faizabad, but, we've got to do what we have to do because, we are in charge of maintaining law and order in the district. And in fact, we had put a couple of the ruling party people behind bars under the NSA as a preventive act. So then the Chief Minister himself came on the line and said, no, you've got to release these people. And as Amitabh said, in a one-on-one, when I explained to Mr. Kalyan Singh, he was very reasonable. And he said, "Theek hai, aapko jo karna hai, aap kar lijiye." And that was the end of the story. But it took that talk and explaining personally. And he said, he was fine with that. So I think if you convey your views in a frank manner, preferably one-on-one, not in writing, they understand and they appreciate the work you're doing.
Okay, we well shot over the time that we had. So let me get wrap-up comments from each of you. And Mr. Maharishi, I'll start by asking you, because somebody sent in a question saying that what is your memory from college which really shaped your career?
uh, I think both my school and my college really taught me pricelessly to repeat this word, this phrase for the end of time, to walk the straight and narrow. That's the everlasting contribution that my school and college made to me. You know, my last words are, when I was a young boy in school, class 7, I happened to see our visitor's book. And President Rajendra Prasad had visited us in 1956. That's when I was 1 year old, so much before me, or maybe earlier. And I saw his remark on the visitor's book, which has stayed with me all my life. And that's the parting word I'd like to say to the, especially to the youngsters who are listening in. Just 4 words he used. He said, be good, do good. And that is a lesson that I have sort of abided by all my life. And that is what I would suggest to everybody, that just be good and do good, and everything else will look after itself.
Where did you spend more time, in the dhaba or in class or in the cafe?
No, I used to work overnight. So that was the, this was still a men's college, Shireen. When I was doing my graduation, this is a men's college. So we all were working the night through. So we used to work till 4 in the morning. So obviously we were obviously at midnight at the dhaba, at 2 o'clock at the dhaba. Dhaba was a much more happening place in our time than subsequently. It declined subsequently. So cafe was never very interesting, especially since I'm a vegetarian.
Mince cutlets didn't excite you. Mr. Kanta, memories from college that shaped your career?
I think one thing which really came out well was, the outstanding teachers and the number of, class friends. This bit about you have to be a multifaceted person to succeed in life, that you have to do multi-dimensional thinking. And it's not that you're good in academics, which is important. I mean, your personal relationship, your ability to take your team along, your ability to think big, all this I've learned from college. And that you may be good in academics, but you have to be also good in sports. I mean, and you have to perform everywhere. And that's one place where Mr. Iyer has miserably failed. He's done extremely well in his career. He's done very well in Swachh Bharat, but he's lost all his matches in golf course with us. The challenge for him is now to beat Mr. Maharishi and me on the golf course.
When are you setting that up, Mr. Iyer? Are you headed back anytime soon to take on these?
No, absolutely. Definitely. So, KP Krishnan, another college alum who may not be on this call, we've got an ongoing series with the CAG and Amitabh. And last time we came pretty close. So, hopefully, in a couple of months, I'll be back. But in terms of memories from college, for me, actually, the cafe was quite important, because as part of being on the tennis team, there was a small budget, nothing like cricket, but we had enough to go out for a good cafe hog after tennis. So that was very useful. And in a sense, that sort of motivated me to try and become a tennis professional, at which I failed. And I was fortunate, because then I stumbled into the civil service. So in a different kind of way, that all helped to getting into the civil service. But coming back to the golf, a lot of practice is going on in the Washington, D.C. area. So we're going to come back very strong when we challenge the CAG and Amitabh, hopefully very soon.
Well, I wish you the very best of luck, Mr. Iyer. Thanks, as always, to Mr. Kant, Mr. Maharishi, and Ms. Iyer for speaking with us here this evening. It's been an enjoyable conversation and a meaningful one as well. And I think there are important takeaways and lessons there for each one of us. Before we wrap things up, let me bring the lawyer on board, Mr. Bhattacharya. Over to you.
Can you hear me, please?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Excellent and very, very enlightening, learning process for me, at least, by the learned author, Mr. Parameshwaran, and Mr. Kant, and Mr. Maharishi. My admiration for all of you has gone up, particularly the way Mr. Kant started and hit the bullseye, that, you know, the rules, the way the rules are to be interpreted, they have to be modified. They are not a means to an end. They have to be amended. They should act as catalyst. That's the crux of the matter in our entire system. You see, there is a called destination. Destination is public good. And there is a called journey. Journey is the rules. All these rules and regulations stand on the way. So therefore, half or 90% of the energy and activities is lost during journey. So therefore, you can hardly reach the desired destination with this kind of complex rules or interpretation of the rules. It's a question of change in mindset that Mr. Kant said. Now, I will take one example of my experience about rules. I was arguing a very high-stake tax matter on behalf of Central Board of Direct Taxes in the Supreme Court. And where the tax department had lost miserably in all the counts. And then the Chief Justice, I mean, Kapadia, he specifically asked me, Mr. Bhattacharya, I was respondent, sort of appellant. Mr. Bhattacharya, now somebody has said you file an appeal. So that's how the file came to me. Now, Mr. Bhattacharya, how is it that Income Tax Department did this to the SEC like that? I said, Lordship, you want me to answer the question truthfully or keep quiet? I mean, if I have an option, I'll keep quiet. You have no option, you have to state. I said, only to harass the SEC. And SEC, my clients, which is the top bosses of the income tax, CBDT, member investigation, X, Y, and Z, everybody was there. They were shocked. And after the hearing, they told me, we briefed you as per, I said, no, you have briefed me right as per you. But as a law officer, I have to argue as per law. And if the law says the Income Tax Department has been harassing the SEC all these years, then I am not the law officer to support you. You give a note and send a note to the Prime Minister that this law officer should be sacked. That you can do. But at the end of the day, everybody was happy. It was a bank chairman called me, believe me, because I have been a banker, you know, half banker, half lawyer. So 80 lakhs standing in the account of a person. And though there is only one beneficiary, he said, sir, because, you know, he was my student in the Bankers Training College of the RBI. I said, sir, 80 lakhs, just between you and me. Should I give us? Of course you give. No. We have sought three legal opinions and this and that succession certificate. I said, you become a clerk. You just demote yourself to a clerk. Just take an undertaking and give it. So this is the way ordinary man, ordinary litigant, ordinary things are being harassed. And in the perspective, if I may put it, 60% of the litigant is the state. I won't say government, central government, state government, public sector, this, that, and the other. And the litigation goes on. Thank you very much. It has been a great learning process for me. Thank you, all of you. So now over to you, our secretary office. Yes, please. Oh, sorry, you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Bhattacharya. We do have someone waiting by for the vote of thanks. Do go ahead. I don't have a name, unfortunately.
Suzanne.
Good evening, everyone.
Just a second. So we have a junior member delivering the vote of thanks. And I mean, I must just quickly add. Okay. Name has gone by, otherwise we would have loved to hear more from everyone. So may I invite now Shiv Akhil Vasanthani. He's a second year chemistry student, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. I, Shiv Akhil Vasanthani, I'm a student of chemistry here in college. And I would like to express my gratitude to our panelists, participants, and everyone who made this evening discussion possible. Firstly, I'd like to thank our panelists, Mr. Parameshwaran Iyer, Mr. Rajiv Maharishi, Mr. Amitabh Khan, and Ms. Shireen Ban, whose lively interaction truly piqued our curiosity, reaching every crevice of our thoughts. I would also like to thank our dear principal, Professor John Varghese, whose support has always been our pillar of strength, and the Alumni Association who organized this event. Last, but certainly not the least, I'd like to thank all of you for your presence blooming throughout the course of the session. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, panelists, once again. Professor Varghese, would you like to come in and add a couple of words?
Thank you, Anne. I just want to say thank you to each and every one of you for your presence here this evening. It's been really very useful and engaging. I want to particularly congratulate Ms. Ban for the wonderful manner in which you took everyone along. And I want to thank Mr. Khan, Mr. Maharishi, and of course, the prime reason for us being here, Mr. Iyer. Thank you so much. And all good wishes to everyone. Please look forward to more of such engaging activities from the Alumni Association. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Anne.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, all of you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Lisa and Shireen, fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Bye. Thanks, Amitabh. Thanks, sir.
Bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye.